I'm Park Howell, and welcome to the Business of Story, where I consult, teach, coach, and speak on the applied science and bewitchery of brand and business storytelling so that you can clarify your story to amplify your impact and simplify your life.
I thought it was just a stupid picture of a pig in the ocean. But after hearing that story, I had to have it. Now I wasn't just buying a picture. I was buying a story. Story literally made the picture worth more money to me.
That's what businesses are about. People buy brands. People buy stories much more than anything else.
I work with a lot of big enterprise companies, but let's just say I always tell folks, drop the PowerPoint, close your laptops, start with your story.
If you want people to get engaged and you want people to act, you have to tell them an emotionally powerful story. That's with great characters, it's with uncertain outcomes, and it's with high stakes and drama.
All business strategy is a story.
Last fall, I found myself on the 17th floor in the 500 West Madison skyscraper in downtown Chicago. I was doing a full-day Business of Story workshop for DiMeo Schneider and Associates, an investment consulting firm with $90 billion in assets under management. Yeah, that's right, $90 billion. I got to know Bob DiMeo, its co-founder and managing partner, on several phone calls during the run-up to our storytelling masterclass. You know, I found him incredibly personable and extremely curious about the power of story in the business-to-business world. Even so, I braced myself for what I anticipated could be a room teeming with hard-charging, clock-watching financial alpha males that bust my chops at every opportunity. But what greeted me was a group of dedicated executives that felt more like a family than hardened investment advisors. It wasn't until later that I learned how Bob and his leaders built this culture, until I learned their story, a story which is built on the beliefs and values Bob shares in his book, 50 Billion Reasons to Grow Your Practice, A Guide to Success and Enjoyment for Investment Advisors. A book he wrote when his firm eclipsed the $50 billion in assets under management mark a few years ago. Bob shares his story and how business storytelling has compounded the growth of his firm from a startup in 1995 to 100 people and 13 partners in 4 offices and one of the top investment consultancies in the country. In addition to growth nuggets pulled from the pages of his book, you'll learn DiMeo Schneider's 3 guideposts to hiring and retaining top advisors, the 3 levers of purpose-driven investing, and the return you can earn on sincerity, listening, and empathy with your customers and colleagues. The great thing is, you don't even need to be in the financial world to benefit from Bob's wisdom. If you have a business-to-business enterprise or are a communications consultant serving B2B clients, then this show is for you. Join us as you'll learn how to turn data into drama to help grow people, careers, fortunes, and positive impact with Bob DiMeo, right now on The Business of Story. Bob, welcome to the show.
Oh, thanks so much, Park. Happy to be with you.
You know, I had such a pleasure last year getting to know you and your team out at DiMeo Schneider and Associates and watching you all grow as storytellers through our 8-week deliberate practice program. So number one, thanks again for bringing me out and for sharing me and my approach with some of your other friends and colleagues out there. But I guess my first question for you, very successful in the financial world, in the investment consulting world, which aren't always known for storytellers. They're known for number crunchers. How did you get into, or why did you start exploring storytelling for you and your firm?
Oh, well, that's a great question, Park. I think it began, and frankly, it was just a firm the other day, but I think it began with me really just trying to have a greater appreciation, and not just me, but myself and my colleagues and partners, a greater appreciation for getting in the batter's box and doing well. In other words, when you really compete to earn a piece of business in our world. Often you'll receive a request for a proposal, and that might come after months or even years of sort of nurturing a prospective client. And then it all ultimately, after turning in a huge response to the RFP, and maybe it started with 10 firms down to three, and now it's three firms competing. You've got 45 minutes each, and your competitors are waiting in the hallway. And I think the original impetus was based on really just trying to be able to connect, trying to maybe differentiate in that time slot that you have.
And so these prospects are not necessarily judging you and your firm on your capabilities. I guess when you hit that level, they already assume that your resume and your background, your capabilities are just the table stakes to be in the game. But now they're really judging you on the character of the organization and what they might expect out of you and your people.
Yeah, well, I think you're spot on, but it took us a lot longer to learn that. And I think, you know, you prepare for a finals pitch, we're analytical by nature, and you really, we've got some proprietary tools and software and all sorts of things we're proud of. And I think our competitors are similar in that fashion. And then the notion is, you know, for an analyst or a consultant, a research person, to really probably want to talk about their wares and so on, and maybe not appreciate as much as we should kind of the importance of connecting and differentiating and really to your very point.
So let's go way back in Bob DiMeo's story. How did you get into the investment consulting business in the first place?
Yeah, well, if we go way back, it would have to, I'd say for many, many years, been passionate about growing exceptional organizations. And that could be companies or that could be nonprofits that I've been involved with. And in fact, it dates back to when I was 16 years old. I opened my first business and it was a carpet cleaning company. And it certainly didn't have a lot to do with investing, but it certainly did teach me how to work hard and teach me about relationships and that sort of thing.
And where did you grow up, Bob?
So I actually grew up born in Chicago and actually grew up pretty darn close to O'Hare Airport. And that was sort of my income and really my part-time job while going to both high school and college.
And how did you get in the carpet cleaning business?
So my father, who was a painter for the Chicago Park District, he actually had a side business where they did kind of big commercial work, if you will. And I say big on a relative sense now, but he and a good friend of the family, good friend of his. And then it was actually myself and the son of the other fella, the partner, who basically said, you know what, we ought to start doing homes and really get into this carpet cleaning business with private residences and so on. And that's when we began that.
So you forewent the grocery bag boy, as I did growing up, or the newspaper route, or working at McDonald's to start your own company at 16.
Yeah, I mean, I did some of those things. I was a newspaper boy at 10, and I remember working as a laborer for bricklayers, and that was a bit of a challenge, and it taught me to stay in school and do relatively well. But sort of my real passion was around really growing this business. And I remember being at family parties and things of that nature, and I don't have any brothers, but my mom's sister had four boys, and so they were kind of all big brothers to me, if you will. And my uncle had an office supply business. And I remember being at a family barbecue or something and just picking their brains on how do you do this and how do you do that. And this was from a very young age. So not to belabor the point, but I've always been a bit passionate about growing businesses and trying to develop process and excellence in business.
So that just came to you naturally, I guess, starting with your first foray into the entrepreneurial world with your carpet business. What did you go on to study? Where did you go to school? And how did that carpet business materialize into who you are today?
Yeah, so, well, it's a great story, but you'll think in some respects I should have stayed in the carpet cleaning business because throughout college, ran the business. You know, I was kind of living the dream, I thought, and it was kind of neat. I was in school, but working the business, I had 10 people working for me. Myself and my partner had 10 people working for us at a point in time, the company van. And that was just really neat, we thought. And working on the logo and the, you know, postcard as a reminder to the customer and things.
What was the name of the company?
So it was Personalized Cleaning Systems, PCS, and we had little keychains we'd leave behind and all that kind of stuff. And then I went to Bradley University in Peoria and majored in business and graduated a bit early. And then I sold the business for about $1,000.
Wow, big money.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And it's kind of funny, my former partner who bought the business, he's got about 1,500 guys working for him now. So he has built a really successful, he's just a wonderful guy and kind of rocking and rolling. And his brother has a large number of electricians. So there's sort of entrepreneurial spirit in the waters here, if you
will. So you're telling me Personalized Cleaning Systems is still a thing?
No, it's not. It's under another name, and okay. Boy, he's taken it in a much better and bigger direction and sort of like large offices and things of that nature. But they're doing great. And then I thought I was pursuing the next dream, which was I had a friend who actually we bought an apartment building together. I remember using part of a student loan as the down payment on an apartment building.
How old were you at this time?
So at this time, I would have been 20 or 21, and this fellow was a little bit older than me. He dated my girlfriend's sister, and we ended up buying this apartment building together, and he ended up becoming a stockbroker. And so when I graduated, you know, I learned about what he was doing, and boy, that seemed really neat and interesting and exciting. And I became a straight commission stockbroker at the age of 21, and of course sold my business, the carpet cleaning company, for all that money, and we were off to the races.
And away you went.
Yes.
So now today, managing partner at DiMeo Schneider and Associates, which you all started in what, 1995?
Yeah, we're coming up. May 1st will be of next year will be our 25-year anniversary. And boy, does time fly.
Well, congratulations. I know I started my advertising agency, Park & Co., in 1995 too. That's why that particular date sticks with me. But as you know, I pivoted away from that about 5 years ago just to focus on business of story. You, on the other hand, have really grown an amazing organization, and you've written a book, The 5 Billion Reasons to Grow Your Practice, A Guide to Success and Enjoyment for Investment Advisors. So being that this is the business of story, how have you used story throughout that time? Maybe not even intentionally, but in looking back, how story has worked for you to help build such a successful investment consulting firm.
Yeah, well, boy, there are so many ways to respond to that. And we, with your help and with other studies and learnings and such, have really tried to connect and integrate storytelling. And I mean in a very good, pure, and high integrity manner. But, you know, obviously I know the numbers. I love the numbers. There was a point and you know, I only half jokingly say, now we've got 99 professionals here. And, you know, we advise on about $90 billion in assets and 4 locations. And I only half jokingly state that I probably couldn't get hired today. But at a point in time, I actually headed up our research effort. And now we've got teams of CFAs and some CPAs and you know, just terrific professionals here on the research and quantitative side. But I would say even when I was knee deep in research, I've always been kind of a story or relationship or parable type guy, a lot of analogies and metaphors. So it probably began with that. And I remember, and still today, if someone is talking with me, I will sort of summarize in my mind what they're saying with a metaphor or or an analogy and share that. And, you know, countless times share, yep, exactly. Or no, or more like, and all of that's good, right? If they affirm that you've got it, or if they redirect you, all of that is good.
So that's interesting. So they're giving you a download. It could be a prospect. It could be a customer, a colleague, or whomever. They're giving you a download on their challenge or what they hope to attain. you listen to that, internalize it, and then you find a metaphor of some sort or a parable or whatever to be able to recast what they told you in another way, just to see if you have the meetings of the mind, if you've got it right.
That's right. That's right. And that's just, I think that's just innate and just a part of my personality. And so that's been in me forever, I think. And then when I started hearing more and learning more about storytelling and reading some books on the subject, ultimately I found you, which was terrific. But then I learned there really is an entire framework that you can place around this and probably should place around it. Again, with, you know, intentionality, but a lot of integrity. And I think it just enhances communication and understanding and things of that nature.
Yeah, and integrity is so important. I'm a big believer that stories deliver the truth, and in that truth is where you create the trust. And if you tell a story that doesn't have the integrity to it that it ought to, the truth will eventually surface. It eventually will come out. So, you know, use story for good, not evil, because it always does reveal a truth, whether you're telling a story about something positive that's happening or, you know, being truthful about something negative that's going down. Story, parables, you know, metaphors are just such a powerful way of doing that. Do you feel like, had anybody taught you this, or was it just something innate that maybe it came from your parents, your upbringing, your, you know, schooling?
Yeah, it's funny. My favorite classes were English and writing and such. And so maybe that's part of, you know, just kind of who I am. I wouldn't say my folks are, you know, really great storytellers, but they're very sincere and really good listeners and very empathetic. And so I think some of those traits carry over.
Yeah, and I think you just described what does make a good storyteller. Being sincere about being in the room and being present with that person, listening first and foremost. Storytelling always begins with story listening. And then through that listening, have understanding for your audience sitting across from you so that you can empathize with the journey they're on and hopefully be there to help them get what they want out of that journey.
That's right.
Yeah. Have you gotten much pushback on storytelling in business, especially as you started to bring it in to your company? And, you know, we took a full day working with your team there, a very, very busy team. And I imagine a lot of them had a lot of other things on their plate besides learning storytelling. Has it been difficult, or because you hear a lot, especially in business to business, high stakes business to business, engineering, investment, law firms, that a lot of times you get people crossing their arms and saying storytelling is just a gimmick. It doesn't really work. Let's just, you know, share the data and the numbers. Did you have to overcome that with your people or even with some of your industry peers?
So really not much pushback. And I think part of that might have been for the investment consulting world, we're relatively large, as I said, approaching 100 people and 13 partners and, you know, kind of a framework in place in a lot of areas, always room to improve and grow. But really, one of our core beliefs is that growth is not an option. It's not optional. And it's not so we can squeeze another nickel into the partners' pockets. It's the only way we can attract and stimulate and retain and reward our talent, which far, far and away is our most important asset. And as you know, in our business goes up and down the elevator every day. So if our mindset is, listen, we must grow for these reasons, really the partnership and management leadership here are pretty attuned to, well, what should and could we be doing so that we can grow more thoughtfully and add the right sort of clients on an ongoing basis?
Yeah. Now, where have you recently seen storytelling really have an impact in your business that may have surprised you?
Well, it's actually come up in a number of different areas. And I used, and actually talked with you a little bit before doing it, but I recall we do a really big number of different programs and so on for our clients, but we do a really big investor conference in the fall, 300 plus attendees, and always a lot of energy, good time, breakout sessions. And I remember in opening that conference, I used story, and I, again, I'm a metaphor and analogy guy. I have always opened the conference. We've run it since 2010. And I will tell you, I was a little bit nervous going into this one because I was probably exposing a bit more, being a little bit more vulnerable. But I remember afterwards folks coming up to me and saying, boy, as you were telling that, and then the step about this and what was going to happen. And I just think, hopefully not sounding modest, but I think it was a nice kickoff to the conference and set a nice tone in the conference. So that's one way. And then there are several other ways that colleagues are using storytelling. I just kind of queried some of the folks that were in the room with you and was really pleased to learn about how story is being used in a number of different ways here.
Yeah. So can you share with us and our listeners the story that you opened your conference with, or is it really only meant for your conference attendees?
No. It's just interesting. Long story short, it basically was me sharing that, boy, we took on this client, a religious order prior to the downturn and the financial crisis, and really helped them in a variety of ways. And then from a performance standpoint and many other respects, really, really did well for them. In fact, they would regularly compliment us. They ultimately ended up, just from a governance or stewardship perspective, going to market. And I will just say this, I think that kind of a shiny toy from a competitor caught their eye, if you will. And it's funny that we had helped this client navigate the financial crisis, and those were pretty challenging times. And I won't, for regulatory and other reasons, mm-hmm. go into any great detail here, but those were challenging times. And I think we did a fine job of helping the client navigate a difficult period. And then after a period of time, here now we're in a 10-year economic expansion and bull market and so on. And for kind of a shiny toy to catch their eyes, it was disappointing. And sort of the therefore, if you will, or the but, that was the but, and the therefore was that it was really an encouragement for committee members and investments in general to think beyond just today and to be careful about extrapolating the most recent forward and to really have some intentionality about what's important to an investment committee or to an institution. And that was kind of a good setup for the rest of the day, where we're having terrific money managers and economists and analysts speaking on a variety of subjects.
So here you had a client, a nonprofit client for quite a while, a good client for you. You were all working well together. You got them through the economic downturn, came out the other end, having some success with them again. And then, as often happens, a competitor shows up, and all of a sudden they, like you say, are the shiny new object, and you lost the business to them. But it was a wake-up call for you and your team. So that, I guess the business point in that is always be looking forward. Don't ever take it, for granted what you have going right now and what you learned in that process.
Yeah, I think that's 100% true. And I would say I'm very pleased with our client retention numbers and things along those lines. And I guess I would just make clear that I don't think we were taking the client for granted. I think a new committee member came on board and said, hey, why don't we look around? And that's okay. That's fair. And I only say this because I sit on some nonprofit boards where we're not the investment consultant. We're using other investment consultants. And I just think it's important not to get caught up in the moment, to really think about what's important to the organization over the longer term. And hopefully all nonprofits, just so they can advance their own mission and survive tough times, which I'm sure will come in the future, that they think in that manner.
Yeah. Bob, what would you say, or how would you articulate the brand story around DiMeo Schneider and Associates, and how does it help guide you and your leadership in attracting, the top talent, retaining the best people, and finding the right clients that really work with your way of doing business?
Yeah, so there are a few things there. I mean, I would probably, if you asked me for differentiators, if you will, I would jump to our three guideposts, and these are something we installed probably over 5 years ago now. And any organization has folks that fit in well and create energy and really are on a rapid and great trajectory. And they probably have folks who are not a great fit. And doesn't mean they're evil or unkind or anything, although sometimes they might be, but more just a poor fit. You probably know Patrick Lencioni. We brought in someone from his organization. And I think this came on the heels of me reading his Three Signs of a Miserable Job. And we ultimately went through a really healthy exercise, which helped us crystallize, memorialize the three hiring guideposts here. And they go obviously beyond hiring. They go to promotion, and they go, even if you're thinking about acquiring a firm, that sort of thing. But the three guideposts for us is, number one, can this person check their ego? And that's not a requirement at all organizations. In fact, at some, it might even be deemed a weakness or a disadvantage. But here, checking your ego, we're not only an open door policy, we're a no door policy. It's all pods and very collaborative and so on. And if someone can't check their ego, it's probably not going to work well from a fit perspective. Number two, are you accountable? And we've all worked with individuals or had relationships with individuals professionally or personally where they're not accountable, where they don't follow through. And it's hard enough to do your own job, let alone following up on someone else who's falling down on commitments. And then the third is thoughtfully driven. So driven is important, right? But it kind of has a negative connotation. And we spent a fair amount of time on this. The thoughtfully driven is, you bet I want to advance. And we've got these bright, hardworking professionals here, and they want to get ahead, but not at the expense of others, hopefully bringing along clients and colleagues with them. So if you ask me for differentiators, I would say the checking the ego, accountable, and thoughtfully driven would be our differentiator.
Yeah, and I really get the sense of working with you and having several conversations since then that you and your firm are much more than just an investment consultancy, but you use the financial world for a bigger purpose. You do a lot of work in the nonprofit world, both volunteering as well as managing the assets and investments for them. Can you talk a little bit about how you have been able to, or what drives you in this purpose-driven direction for your firm?
Sure. And there's sort of an investment-related component and then another. And on the investment side, we use a practice we call the three levers. And we simply feel any investor, hospital, university, pension fund, private individual, any investor has three levers that they should be really assessing. And that would be inflows, outflows, and required return, right? And then we simply say that as an investor, think about a hospital or university, they are not in the investment business. So if they could achieve their investment goals, or even you, Park, as an individual, if you could achieve your investment goals, investing 100% in treasury bills, you should. And people used to laugh at me when I would say that. And I said, no, really, think about it. It's the safest, most liquid asset class in the world. Why wouldn't you do that and then spend your energy in other places? Well, of course, most investors can't achieve their financial goals by simply investing in treasury bills. But it's a really nice framework to say, okay, so if we're adding risk, we're doing it with the exclusive purpose of achieving our required rate of return. We're not doing it because this other committee I sit on, they invest in that, or the guy at the club invests in this. We actually try to look at the three levers, inflows, outflows, required return. And we try to almost make it clinical and say, you're adding a dormitory in 3 years, that will cost this. And you're concerned about your credit rating. So we want to invest in this amount of liquidity or whatever the case may be. And it's just a bit more of a clinical approach, if you will, to striking an asset allocation and ultimately an investment strategy.
Mm-hmm. And it seems pretty straightforward, inflows, outflows, required returns. But I'd imagine in the investment world too, is you have to kind of shy away from the shiny new objects and the new investment instruments that pop up to give that a go with a client and saying, no, what really is in service to what they're looking to accomplish with their money?
That's right. You know, so we serve retirement plans. That's a meaningful, important part of our business. We serve nonprofit clients, the hospital, university, charity, and so on. We serve private clients, the families and such. Then we actually sell research. It's a smaller part of our business, but we have so many folks doing research here that we sell research to other investment advisors and some trust companies and the like. And so, you know, it's really our approach to, particularly when working with those first three, to just try to help them create a strategy that fits with, really can align with their mission, if you will. And this gets back to your earlier question of, how do we sort of tie what we do to the, particularly if it's a nonprofit? And when you're in there and you're really trying to understand, okay, you're attempting to help more sick children, or you're attempting to provide more books to underprivileged individuals, or whatever the case may be. We work with nearly 150 nonprofit clients. And when you can correlate the actual structure of the investment portfolio with advancing their mission, then you've got something.
Yeah, I mean, that's exciting stuff. It's not just building wealth for wealth's sake, it's building wealth for impact.
Impact's a great term, and purpose. And you might remember Christine, she participated when you were here doing the trainings, but I was asking her about how are you using ABT and storytelling and so on. And she mentioned she and a team, they were down at a finals pitch to a nonprofit in Florida a few weeks ago, which I found out since we have won, which is wonderful. But she was telling the committee with the nonprofit that they were visiting another nonprofit client of ours. So she's with the prospect, making the finals pitch, competitors in the hallway, you know, that kind of thing. And she's explaining to them, we just visited another nonprofit. I think they were probably familiar with them. And she mentioned that not only do we do the quarterly meeting, which is sort of common, how did we perform against goals and things of that nature, but beyond the standard quarterly report, she mentioned how our team, Christine and others, join this client in a service project. And really what that ended up doing was help this prospect understand that this goes way beyond just the numbers for us, that it's client relationships, truly trying to understand, and if we can, advance their mission.
Yeah. So you just have a very powerful story there that reveals the character of the organization. Doesn't focus on the credentials of the organization. That's a given. That's table stakes. But telling stories and sharing stories and participating in those stories that demonstrate the character and the personality of the company. I think that is awesome. So you wrote this book, 50 Billion Reasons to Grow Your Practice. And I read through it the other day. Thank you for sending it over. And I realized that you can apply your insights to any industry, especially in the B2B world, not just in the investment business. Why did you decide to write the book? And tell us about the headline.
Yeah. So first I'll say I've been blessed in that I don't work with as many clients as I used to. But if you look over the years, for some reason, we have a number of law firm clients. We have some very large architectural firm clients and really some of the biggest architectural and law firm clients around. And I would do, let's say, the standard, what Christine was talking about, the standard quarterly meeting. These are what the investments did over the last 90 days or so. And then I almost feel like I had an unfair advantage because I would tug on the shoulder of the managing partner of a 1,000 attorney law firm. And I'd start asking about growing the practice and what's an income partner versus an equity partner and so on. So I've been on literally, it feels like a few decade tutorial here. In terms of writing the book, and it's the first book I've written that wasn't more technical in nature. You know, the others are on nonprofit asset management and 401k management, things of that nature. This one, I had a strange confluence, really a fortunate confluence of events in just a one-week period, where I was asked by someone who hired us probably now close to 20 years ago. He headed up the research effort for a pretty large brokerage firm, and they hired our firm. It was actually the first time we were hired in this capacity to provide research on funds and managers and things of that nature, kind of an extension of staff for them. So that's wonderful. And so now he is with a mid-size RIA. This is, you know, 15 plus years later. And he's the chief operating officer for this firm.
And an RIA is?
Apologies, registered investment advisor. So
thank you.
Thank you. So he's the chief operating officer for this registered investment advisor. And he said, hey, I'd love to have you chat with our CEO. Can we just arrange a quick call? And I remember I was outside of a building. It was a fall day and I took this call and I was happy to chat. And I did not know the CEO, but he said to me, and I'm sincere when I say this, it was kind of embarrassing. He said, Bob, I just want to thank you. I used to be on our industry, the Investment Management Consultant Association board, and maybe he saw me speak in the past, or I'm not sure, but he said, I just want to thank you for all you've done in our profession. He kind of went on and on, and I just kind of nudged things along. And then they asked questions and growing practices, and I was just happy to help because this other fella gave us a real opportunity many years ago. So it was my pleasure to help. That combined with 1 week later, Jenna, who you know and heads up our marketing effort, she lets me know we just crossed $50 billion in assets under advisement. And I think if you add up, I read a stat recently, all the registered investment advisors, there are over 15,000 in the United States. And I think only 1% have over $1 billion under advisement. So the $50 billion was kind of a real milestone. And I'm normally put your head down, run to the next thing. In fact, I think that's often a good thing to do, kind of take momentum and keep it going. But I just felt, boy, this is something special. And it's far from simply me. It's a large group of partners and managers and leaders and colleagues and clients that really have made this happen. And that's when I decided pretty much right then and there, you know what, I'm going to write this book. I want to, in some way, provide something that can help other investment advisors or consultants, hopefully not only have a successful practice, but really enjoy and have some work-life balance along the way.
And when did you hit that $50 billion
mark? So I think that would have been in 2013.
So in under 20 years.
Right.
Since you started in 1995, you hit $50 billion in assets under management, and now you're at $90 billion.
Right. Now we're right around $90 billion.
Yeah. And I know you, and you don't say that, you know, to pound your chest. It's just the kind of impact you're making in the world. But I can tell you when I read this book, I thought, well, I wonder what I'm going to get out of it because I'm certainly not an investment advisor. But I can tell you the insights you have in this, anybody can use this and really have an appreciation. It just happens that you are using the investment, you know, world as your vehicle to share your knowledge about being a good person, working hard and diligent on behalf of your customer and your colleagues, and then how to balance and weave that into a life that really is rewarding on all aspects.
Oh, well, thank you. And I think even, you know, it's broken up into six parts. And I think the work-life balance section, I've had folks who have nothing to do with our business say, that was really helpful. And that's heartwarming, right? If in some way, shape, or form, because that's all I've done is basically, you know, read a lot, listen a lot, model a lot, ask a lot. And so if some of that can manifest itself and somehow making things better or easier for someone else, that's wonderful.
Can I then jump into the life balance here just quickly? Let's cover a couple of the points you have in part four. And by the way, you've got 42 chapters in this book, but I don't want to scare anybody off because each chapter is anywhere from 2.5 to maybe 4 pages long. So they're like these brilliant little insights or big insights that come together. So in life balance, you have chapter 36, a life plan. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, so they're just talking about intentionality and why do we exist? Why do you exist? And why would folks take the time to, you know, develop a business plan or a career plan and really not spend some time on a life plan? And I don't want to be too overboard with this, but I will simply say, and this was a wonderful woman who was in practice management who helped me with this years ago and some other readings and such, but if at the end of the day we have some really understanding of our purpose, I think it can, I'm talking about a purpose for being here, I think it can make a lot of the other decisions, the other challenges, the other efforts easier.
And you just have to have that plan in place so it kind of helps you guide where you're going with
That's
it.
That's right.
Yeah. All right, another one you have here. Chapter 37, unsustainable. Sometimes change is required. Can you take us to a moment in your life or in your career that this really played out, that what you were doing was unsustainable and whether you liked it or not, you had to change?
I can, Park, and it's happened several times. You know, I'm not smart enough to learn. We all sort of, our frontiers move, right? We master something, we get good at it again, we start taking more on, and then we've got a new frontier, and then, you know, almost like the boiling water, something sneaks up on us again. So I don't want to suggest at all that I've mastered it, but I've come to recognize it a little bit better. And it's something I chat with, particularly our younger professionals here about, because they are smart and hardworking and diligent and caring. And so you have to guard yourself against this. But long story short, one example would be, you know, so I've been managing partner of the firm since inception in various roles. I said head of research at a point, or manager search and various things. But basically at a point in time that I'm talking about, which would have been, let's call it 10 years ago, I was working with clients, managing the business, my duties there, and then developing business. And maybe my time was a third in that fashion. And Bill Schneider, who's older than me, he was winding out of the business, and he happened to have responsibilities over marketing. And frankly, I took over the marketing from him. Part of it is I really enjoy marketing and it's stimulating to me and so on. And part of it is we needed someone to do that. And so I took partner responsibilities there. And boy, that's actually when we started the conference and we found a real rhythm to our newsletters and our content and our communications. And, you know, Jenna, other, I mean, just so many wonderful folks who really pulled together. But I was really stressed and strained. And it took me a little bit of time to realize, wait a minute, I took on a fairly meaningful role and I haven't given up anything. And so I'd like to ask folks to think of it this way. If it's just muscling through, right? You've got to be at the office late a few nights or the weekend or what have you. We've got a project. And if it's situational, that's one thing. But if it's structural, you need to raise your hand. We need to figure out, do we need another body? Do we need more training? What do we need to do structurally? Because if you burn yourself out, you're no good to yourself. You're no good to the organization or to clients.
And that was your realization. So you had to make a change there because what you were doing was unsustainable.
That's right. That's right.
All right. And then my final one before I let you go here, Bob, I just always love talking to you. You have such great wisdom in life in general. But coming from an investment advisor, you've got chapter 41, don't let money control you. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, so we're in a business, a money business, and money has never been my top priority. And I think if you're in the money business, I think I'm a little blessed to be in the Midwest, maybe as opposed to one of the coasts as well. And so maybe this is a little easier. Maybe things would be more challenging if I were on a coast. But here, I think in the money business, but really in any profession or any individual, can sometimes overvalue money. And there's some quote out there. I think I saw it in a movie on Hemingway. And I think the quote was, you know, he wasn't talking about Hemingway, he's talking about someone. He's so poor, all he has is money. And and right, if you think about it, I think if money really is a top priority, it's going to be a challenging life, and it'll be hard to be there for yourself and be there for others. And listen, most folks don't have that as a number one priority, but I think all of us at times might sort of, whether it be money or any other thing, you know, we sometimes can fall into adoring something a bit more, and that comes back to the life plan and what's really important to me and what questions am I asking myself and, you know, who's keeping me honest on these sorts of things and so on.
Yeah. Well, it's a terrific book. Congratulations on writing it, producing it, publishing it. Where can people find it?
Oh, it's on Amazon. I think that's probably the best way. And, you know, maybe we'll update it when we cross the $100 billion threshold. But Amazon would be the best way to acquire it.
And you can update it, but it's pretty timeless advice, you got to admit. Well
thank
done.
You. Thank you so much, Mark.
Well, Bob, thank you so much for being here. Really, really great having you on the show.
My pleasure. It's been great chatting with you, and really appreciate you having me on.
All right. Thank you all for listening to this edition of The Business of Story. If you like what you heard here and you've got a business, a boss, a manager, a colleague, or whomever that maybe is so caught up in the numbers, caught up in the data, and they're not maybe as effective as you feel they could be, share this episode with them. Bob, I think, does just a terrific job of explaining and detailing how they are using storytelling to grow their firm exponentially. So please feel free to share this show with someone you feel like could really benefit from crafting and telling compelling stories that sell. And of course, if I can be of service to you, you know where to find me at The Business of Story. Would love to have you come over. And if you have any questions for me on how to enact storytelling in your business, especially in the B2B world, I'm always here to help leaders of purpose-driven brands excel through the stories they tell. And remember always that the most important story you will ever tell is the story you tell yourself. So make it a great one. Thanks so much for listening.